Posazhennikova from Royal Holloway University, which will be talking about thermalization of cold bosons by dynamical heat bath generation.
Please. Thank you. So today, indeed, I'll talk about non-strongly correlated system, but this is a very general problem, as you will see, which in principle even independent of statistics. I will talk about thermalization of a closed quantum system by mechanism termed dynamical heat bath generation, DBG. And this work is more or less summarized in these two recent publications. It's actually the strong correlation group of Bonn, namely with Hans Krocher and Mauricio Trujillo Martinez. Yeah, so it's an honor and a pleasure to be here, to be invited here to celebrate with Pierce, his birthday. And indeed, in the condensed matter community, Trieste is indeed associated in many ways with Pierce, who was a driving force behind numerous workshops and schools, as we learned today from 1992 onwards. And his basically endless and boundless energy and drive, I'm sure, inspired zillions of scientists from all over the world. And as you can see, it also inspired his colleagues not only in physics, but also in other creative ways. For example, these drawings from Alexei. That's kind of typical representations of Pierce of that time, especially this one. This is really quintessential Pierce. Beware, I'm listening to your talk, one word wrong, and your days are numbered. Okay, but Pierce, I did not put any year because Pierce is time independent. However, he is interested in many problems in physics which are time-dependent, so including non-equilibrium. So non-equilibrium is among his very broad range of interests. And that's actually how we also work together on some non-equilibrium problems in strongly correlated system, in particular in condam quantum dots. And then I drifted away to, so I got interested in transport and just wanted to apply some of these ideas to actually non-correlated systems, for example, to bosons. And started collaborating with this Bonn group. And after some time, we actually arrived to a very general question which can be asked, which is, can a closed quantum system thermalize? At first glance, this is a very strange question because, as we know, a closed quantum system is described by a pure state, and it evolves according to unitary time evolution, which prohibits maximization of entropy, and thermalization is impossible. Yeah, so when system is not coupled to any thermal bath, it cannot thermalize, as we all know. And as an example here, I took a pool of cold atoms, and this is because these systems are realized experimentally, and they're supposed to be extremely well isolated from any environment. However, experiments, these were first experiments, and some numerical simulations showed that actually thermalization is possible in such systems. And then there is a question, why is it possible, even independent of statistics? But these experiments are in the cold bosons. So there are several ideas on the market. Why is it possible? And one of them is referred to as ETH, which has nothing to do with Zurich, but means eigenstate, just abbreviation for eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. It's a very popular conjecture nowadays, but still it remains conjecture. And I just wanted to briefly kind of bring you through these ideas just to show the limitations of this conjecture. Actually, the idea is very simple. We all know about ergodic classical ergodic problem from our first lecture in any statistical physics course. So these people, this dates back to 90s, to Deutsch and Srednitsky. So these people wanted basically to formulate a quantum analog of basically classical ergodic problem. So as we know, a classical ergodic problem is impossible to solve, and I mean to prove, right? In general case, only in a couple of particular cases. And so they had this idea that maybe for quantum system, so for quantum case, it's actually easier. And indeed, so their conjecture goes along these following lines. So when we have system, yeah, so some closed system in some pure state, initial pure state, so we can always expand it over some basis, and as a basis we choose, for example, energy eigenstates. This psi n's, these are energy eigenstates, c n's are the coefficients, as usual normalized, so all is fine. And then, so when we want to follow the time evolution of the state, we just need to add an exponent here, yeah, according to the Schrödinger equation. So now what we need to do, so what we want to prove kind of, is the long time average of some physical observable, for example, it's called A, is equivalent to a microcanonical average. So in quantum mechanics, we know what dependence of physical observable is. This is just that, right? Where A and M, these are matrix elements with this energy eigenstates. And if you look closely at the sum, so time dependence is only here, right? It can be split into a diagonal sum, end of diagonal, plus off diagonal terms. But then when we calculate the long time average, we need to divide by t, remember, and send t to infinity. And then the off-diagonal terms will give these oscillating terms, which are vanishing in the long time limit. And that's why so the long time average of a physical observable will have just this simple expression. And now there is, however, a little small problem with this expression, because this expression depends on Cn's, and Cn's are these expansion coefficients of their initial state, right? So it means that the long time average depends on initial state, which should not be the case, right, when the system is thermalized. And that's why, so there is this discussion, so that this kind of, this is referred to as so-called a diagonal ensemble. So the discussion follows along the following way. So that in order to fulfill the condition that this doesn't depend on these coefficients, basically in very stupid way to see it, we need to take this out. And if you want to take this out, we need to assume that, you know, this distribution of these diagonal terms is very narrow. And this would follow from actually a very narrow distribution of the eigenvalues of the energy E. So if ENs have a narrow distribution around some average state E, yeah, so then this A and N will be also narrow distributed and so on. And then this long time average does not depend on the initial conditions anymore. And then actually it is trivially shown that it is equivalent to a microcanonical average. So here theta is the number again, number of eigenstates in a very narrow area in energy. Okay, and then they say that's fine, then it means that thermalization occurs at the level of individual eigenstate of a given Hamiltonian. However, so there are several assumptions made during this proof. And first of all, the non-degeneracy of majority of many-body eigenstates, because otherwise all these off-diagonal terms will not vanish. Then the narrow distribution of eigenenergies. This is another assumption crucial for their derivation. And then another assumption that within this narrow energy range, yeah, so all these kind of diagonal elements of physical observables should be kind of also very close to each other. So this ETH hypothesis, you know, lies on the very narrow kind of slice of the hypersurface. So there are many problems, and because of these limitations, it is very difficult to formulate some general kind of concept of, you know, to which system it is applied and how each system will thermalize. So that's why it's only possible to check each time numerically what happens. And moreover, we also notice even some contradictions here, because once, you know, there is a narrow distribution of, for example, of this eigenenergies, right? So then you cannot actually put this diagonal of diagonal elements to zero in the long time limit. Okay, so we wanted to consider a more kind of general case. First of all, what if ETH conditions are not fulfilled? And then can a system thermalize? And if yes, then how? Because ETH doesn't tell you how the system thermalizes. So basically, what happens dynamically to the system? What are the leading timescales when a closed system thermalizes? It just tells you if it thermalizes, then why, right? So we want to ask a much more broad question. And for just as an example, yeah, we chose the simplest non-equilibrium system, which is a Bose-Josephson junction. First of all, it is isolated, it is out of equilibrium, and these are weakly interacting bosons, which are in principle not so difficult to treat. So basically, the only condition we have is that our system is macroscopic. The Hilbert space dimension is very large, which is true already for, you know, number of particles, even 25. It's already very large. And then initially, it doesn't need to be in this very narrow distribution of eigenstates, but on the contrary, very broad distribution initially usually follows for this kind of systems. So OK, so what we have is called condensate in a double well potential. This is how Bose-Josephson junction is realized in experiments. And what we do initially at time zero is just quench the Josephson junction, yeah, the coupling basically between the wells. So, and then we see if the system thermalizes or not and how. And we showed that actually the system does thermalize under certain conditions, and it proceeds during this thermalization or way to the thermal state. It proceeds through several stages, which I will describe a little bit in more detail later. But basically, what happens is that the system generates its own bus dynamically as a result of a parametric resonance. So let me tell you more details of how we do the calculations. Okay, first of all, we need to choose a basis, and the basis for the problem is their exact single particle eigenstates of the double well. So basically, one takes a double well potential, solves a single particle Schrödinger equation, and here is your basis. Yeah, but again, what is very important about this system, again, that it is not very large, so that the levels are discrete. So discreteness is very crucial point, yeah, for our description and for our mechanism of thermalization. Okay, so this will be the basis, and then we just expand the bosonic field operator over this basis. In principle, so when number of levels is infinite, this is exact. But of course, we have to do some approximations. Namely, we truncate the basis basically at seven levels. So two lowest levels we assume are filled with condensate, and the higher levels in this double well potential are described quantum mechanically by this B operator. So these are basically quasi-particles, excitations out of condensate. And then we just plug this expansion in the general Hamiltonian with the contact interaction, yeah, described by the constant G. And then derive all kinds of terms. Sorry. Let me. So there will be, of course, terms, you know, associated with the condensate and interactions and these quasi-particles and interactions between them, all kinds of. Then interactions between quasi-particles and condensed particles and all kinds of mixed terms. Then in addition to that, there will be Josephson, typical Josephson term plus Josephson renormalized term, basically Josephson-assisted, quasi-particle-assisted tunneling in, and there will be also inelastic collisions, which will be responsible for eventual thermalization, if at all. And then what we do, we derive, so in time, yeah, so we keep the two times, and the derive equation of motions for example, condensate amplitudes. I just show you just one example for condensate amplitude, and you will see it will be renormalized by all these normal and anomalous Green's functions of the quasi-particles. And then we solve them self-consistently. And let's look at the results. So what is plotted here is the so-called population imbalance. So it's a difference. Population difference between the two wells, so N1 is population of one well, N2 is the population of the second well, yeah, normalized by the total particle number, yeah, which stays constant. So, and what is, you can see, first of all, that this is indeed the system thermalizes nicely, yeah, because actually we will see why, because this quasi-particle excited, yeah, and because of the quasi-particle collisions. And we also did the logarithm plot of this population imbalance, and you see it's perfectly fitted by a linear. So which means that there is exponential approach of the thermal state. So basically now, if we return to this picture, what is plotted here is from this time, so there is several time scales. So initially, no quasi-particles are excited, and there are this just semi-classical Josephson oscillations between the wells. So here, what is plotted here is from this time scale, when the quasi-particles are excited and then contribute to eventual thermalization of the system. And there is this vertical line, which I will explain a bit later. So in order to understand better what is going on, we're also plotting the occupation numbers of the levels in the double well. Okay, so what we see again, so if we in this regime, which is kind of blue, yeah, regime, we see that these levels are not occupied. So here there are no quasi-particles excited. Then there is regime 2 between tau C and tau F, which is characterized by an abrupt excitations of those quasi-particles. Yeah, you see that it's very strong. So these are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the brown curve is the sum of all five quasi-particle levels. And then you see there is a third regime, which shows actually thermalization and the slow relaxation to a stationary state. So in order to better understand the physics of the system, one actually needs to do spectral analysis. Namely, we need to do a Fourier transform of the two-time Green's function. So this is the Fourier transform of the spectral function with respect, so we introduce Wigner coordinates as usual, so this is Fourier transform with respect to the difference of times, right? And this is for large times in second Wigner coordinate. So basically this gives us the spectrum, yeah, for large times, spectrum of this quasi-particle subsystem. And remember, we had five levels, so as expected, we see actually five peaks, and these are renormalized Rabi frequencies. What is extremely surprising is when you take condensate in this phase where it's not in the stage where it's not thermalized yet and just do a Fourier transform, this is the red line, it actually knows pretty well about this kind of peaks. So you can almost overlap them. And this means that the quasi-particle subsystem and this condensed subsystem, they're extremely strongly coupled in this regime, in this regime here. However, when you Fourier transform the condensate part, at later times, it completely, you see, it is completely decoupled from quasi-particles. It means so that we got from effectively extremely strongly coupled regime for condensate and the quasi-particle subsystems where you cannot separate them and you cannot tell the two subsystems from each other to a weakly coupled regime when they effectively decoupled, And then once they become effectively decoupled, they begin to serve as thermal bus for each other, okay? So each, for example, quasi-particle subsystem acts as a thermal bus for condensate and grand canonical ensemble and vice versa. Okay, so and then we check that the system thermalizes by checking how it approaches the Bose distribution with time. Okay, so this is a bit speculative, but however, so there is this inflation model for the universe, and basically the idea is that the inflation happened because of this highly excited inflaton field. And this is kind of similar to us, how is a preparation of system in non-equilibrium state. And inflaton field is actually very analogous to the Bose-Einstein condensate. And all these density oscillations and elementary particle energies, they actually resulted as a, they came as a result of a parametric resonance. And we have very similar effect. We have parametric resonance of Bose, so Einstein, Josephson oscillations and the quasi-particle Rabi excitation energies. And then there is decoupling on inflaton by expansion, and we also have freeze-out of or quasi-separation of those quasi-particles from condensate due to energy conservation. Okay, so this was just for fun. And to conclude, so we show basically the way how a closed quantum system can thermalize and how it goes through several stages during this thermalization, and that the bus is not to be there, even it does not need to be there even at initially, how it, so the system kind of generates its own bus. And so there are at least three regimes associated with this behavior. And so as an outlook, we can expand this model to lattices and to generic many-particle systems and apply to realistic trap potentials. Okay, thank you for your attention.